Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Everybody, welcome to the June episode of Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. My name is Kendra Cook,
and I'm Dan.
Here with Dan Olsen. Hi, Dan.
Hi.
We are excited to be here today. We have some neato stuff to talk about, right? It's always neato.
Neato.
Groovy.
Groovy.
Neato,
yeah. Solid.
Cool. But before we get to our topics, a little bit about the Boyertown Museum. We are located at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania, and we are open 7 days a week for visitors. We would absolutely love to see you there. We're open from 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And if you'd like to learn more about us, give us a call, 610-367-2090. Send us an email, mail, at boyertownmuseum.org. And, of course, the best way is to always stop in and look at the cool stuff on this.
Absolutely.
Slide. It's always the best. We are closed major holidays, so we will be closed on July 4th, but we're open the whole rest of that week. So if you've got family in visiting, great time to come visit us. We're just closed on the actual Independence Day, but we're open the 3rd and the 5th. Mm-hmm. So we're there.
Probably the 2nd and the 6th also.
And the 2nd and the 6th and then the 1st and the 7th. You get the idea. Mm-hmm. So we'll be there waiting for you, and you might be lucky enough to catch one of us and quiz us on something in the museum.
Quiz. and I'm going to interrupt here. I do a lot of tours, and in the past 2-3 weeks, we had a slew of tours, including 256
kids.
Graders, okay, from Boyertown Junior High. But also, we had some I did a couple of senior groups from, I think they were from two senior home residents.
Yep.
And also a car club came in, Mercedes-Benz, local club, and it was neat. And, you know, we have a lot of people come in and think, oh, we're just a car museum, which a majority of the things are that, but there's so much more. And, you know, I'm looking out our front window right now, and we have a young family walking by, okay? And, you know, Kendra, I have a feeling you probably try to reach out to the kids as well as the parents, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And there is stuff there that interests things. And
yeah.
I think your interest, Kendra, you delve into the stuff, it's not just the vehicle.
Yeah.
But, you know, what's hanging on the vehicle or, you know, what's the backstory behind it? And that's
right.
What makes it interesting. So if you people out there are watching, and Kendra just invited, you know, bring your family, friends, whatever.
Definitely.
And you think, well, you know, they're not interested in cars. Well, there's enough other things there.
There is.
Know?
And so. The kids are free. 15 and under are free.
Free is good.
And as someone with 3 kids under 15, that's really nice.
Yes.
To know that
yes.
I don't have, because sometimes, despite your best efforts, the kids just don't appreciate it or they're in a bad mood. We've all had those days.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't feel like you've totally...
Yeah, I've never was that way.
You were a perfect angel, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
But you're right. I'm not like a gearhead. I don't... Mechanics very often go over my head, but there's plenty there that I enjoy and am interested in.
Mm-hmm.
Just the stories
and
behind the cars.
Especially since most of the vehicles, a majority of the vehicles... Not or just Pennsylvania, but from this area,
yes.
Berks County and We'll say the surrounding counties too.
Yes,
so, a lot of local history.
Yeah, a lot of names, town names you recognize.
Yep.
I've had people recognize family names that are on the.
Okay.
The signs, mm-hmm. you know, some founder of the company or someone who once owned it or something. Mm-hmm. They recognize those people. We were just talking before we came on. We just we've been doing some construction at the museum. Mostly in our lobby and in a conference room, which not everyone sees because it's, you know, it's not open to the public necessarily, but it's in that area. And everything below the diner, that area of the museum, was kind of off limits for a while because mm-hmm. the contractors were using that as a work area to store supplies and tools and things like that. Well, we just filled that back up this past week with Han trucks, H-A-H-N, and Han was out of Hamburg, mm-hmm. Pennsylvania, so one of our Berks County neighbors. And what's really neat, there are three big trucks back there, three different decades, 1915, a 1926, and a 1937. And one's a fire truck, one's a coal truck, and one's a what do you want to say, like a panel, not a panel, like a delivery, kind of huckster looking truck.
Like that.
They're big.
Big.
But they all drove in there from the warehouse mm-hmm. on their own power, which is really cool. We're really proud of that.
Kip is probably proud too.
Kip was really excited. Yeah. So we have great volunteer mechanics that got mm-hmm. those things up and running. The fire truck, I don't think it's been on display in over 20 years. So, and one of the reasons is because it doesn't drive and it's really hard to move. And now we got it up and running
works.
And we drove it across the street and pulled it right in and it was not easy to steer, but it made it. That's what matters. So it's neat to have all, we were saying, it's neat to have all them together. Mm-hmm. You know, one company's vehicles down there, you kind of see like, I don't know, it's just cool to see them all together.
Mm-hmm.
They're friends.
Okay.
So before we get to our topics, I do want to say there's a couple of events and exhibits coming up at the museum that I wanted to share with you a little bit. And the first thing I'll throw up there on the screen is our newest temporary exhibit, special exhibit this summer. We're officially opening it on Thursday, June 22nd. From 5 to 6:30 in the evening. Where we're going, we don't need roads, a Back to the Future tribute. So that car you see there is the same one on display in the museum lobby right now. It is not a car out of the movie. It wasn't used in the movie, but our guest curator, Mr. Tom Silknitter, he built that car essentially using the museum or the movie specs. So it's pretty accurate and it looks great. He did a really great job. It looks like straight out of the film. So this is his tribute car, but also on display along with it is some movie memorabilia. There's you know, toys and games that came out along with the Back to the Future movie. There is stuff from the movie itself, some handwritten notes that the production department and art department made to develop this car. And it's really neat. We're really excited to have it. So if you want to join us on Thursday, June 22nd, we would love to have you. $10 for members, $15 for non-members. If you're interested in joining us, please contact us at the museum to register. And we'd love to see you there. We're really excited to have this for the summer. We have a couple of other, let's say, events, programs to go with this that are going to happen later. July 22nd, we're going to show a documentary that was made about making the cars for the film. The documentary director, hopefully will be there to join us as well for that, and some other people involved with it to have a little Q&A afterwards. We're going to have a trivia night, and also, our guest curator here wrote a book about building this tribute car, so we're also going to have him in at some point and do like a book signing and get to meet him, and he can talk a little bit more about the process. So again, we're really excited to have this exhibit, and I'll have more details for those other events next month. But I wanted to get the exhibit opening out to you now, so hopefully you can join us on June 22nd. We also, later this summer, will be hosting our second Cars and Cones, which we did this last summer. And our parking lot, if you visited us, is a sizable parking lot. I think we have about 103 spaces, and all spaces were filled. For this, it was really popular. We had lots of cars and all different types. We had street rods and hot rods. We had muscle cars. We had some really nice station wagons from the 50s. And we had some, you know, Fords and Chevys and Pontiacs. And we had everything. So it was a really neat event.
There was one thing you were missing, though.
Ice cream?
Me.
We were missing you.
I wasn't there.
You're going to make it up this year, right?
Yeah, I'll go there twice.
Okay, good. Yeah. You get two ice cream cones. Two.
Okay, two. Yeah, got it.
Make up for last year. So this is in our parking lot from 4 to 6:30 on Thursday, August 10th. And Mr. Softy will be there. You can get ice cream from them. Now, if you want to bring your car, you know, cruise in, that's free. If you're a spectator and just want to walk around the parking lot and check out the cars, that's also free to do. The museum will be open, but we will have regular admission rates to get in the museum. The Back to the Future exhibit will still be there, so maybe that's a night you want to go check that out. If evenings are better for you, that might be a good time to go check out Back to the Future. And then, of course, Duryea Day is also swiftly coming up, Saturday, September 2nd, at Boyertown Community Park from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m.
Is that Chuck's car?
You know what? It's not. I thought it was.
Okay.
And he came to get a flyer because he wanted one with his car, and he goes, "That's not mine. It's close, but it's not his."
Chuck is our in-house DJ.
Yes.
Right? Would I say that right?
Yes. Yeah. I really thought that was his. He's got one of those. They're cute. I love a couple of them usually show up for Duryea Day. I think there's a local-ish club, right? I think they come and they're members.
Those cars have little bitty engines, but Chuck says he has a V8 and he opened a hood and he has a can of V8 vegetable juice.
That is
so you had to look
very
for
Chuck humor. I like
yes.
it.
Yes.
So we hope you join us on Labor Day weekend. Spectators, it's $10 to get into the park, but that also gets you to the museum. Includes your museum admission, so that's a pretty good deal. And if you want to register your car, you want to show your or truck or motorcycle, we'd always love to have more motorcycles.
Mm-hmm.
You can contact us at the museum. We'll help you out with that, getting your car registered. And day of show registration is available. You can wait till the day of if you'd like to. But Boyertown Community Park is really nice. I like using it. It's got the nice open ball fields, but then it's got the nice
shade.
Wooded area. And we're looking forward to it.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully you can join us for Duryea Day as well. So that's what I've got coming up on the schedule. And now, I'm going to throw it back to you.
Throw it back to me.
Yeah.
Okay. We don't have a date yet, but we're working on Diner Day. It's November. Check your website. Check our website,
right? We are working
See,
on...
See, I have to throw that in there.
He does. And we are working on it.
We are.
We have developments every day.
Do you know, I keep talking about it. Maybe if things don't work out, I will have to do it myself.
I will
make the homemade
pies. I was
going
to say, you could make a pie, stand behind the counter.
That wouldn't be good.
I'll get you an apron. You could be like the
I could do that.
Serve.
Mel. I could do Mel. Isn't he the diner guy?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so, yeah.
I could do that.
Okay.
Yeah. But about making the pies, no. Okay. You ready for me now?
Oh, I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm born ready.
I came across, no, I didn't come across. I met a friend of mine and his wife about a month ago, and we were looking at a collection of vehicles, and his wife, Don and Sue. His wife, Sue, says, oh, I like all the accoutrements here. So we say, what is an accoutrement? I've heard the word. I kind of had an idea of it. Well, then they started saying something about me presenting something on this program. So I thought, well, okay, yeah. So I have accoutrements. So that's what I'm going to be talking about. Okay. So for those of you who do not know what the word accoutrements means, it's accessory item of clothing or equipment, trappings, an accessory adapter, add-on, attachment, option. Okay, it covers a lot. Stuff, okay? Stuff is a good word.
Yeah.
That's the key word here. Okay, so we look at a car and there's accoutrements on our cars today, okay?
Yeah.
Such as, you know, extra cup holders, mm-hmm. heated seats, okay? Mm-hmm. You have all that kind of stuff, okay? But since we're not talking about today's cars, let me go back. In the 50s, they had some really cool things like record players in the car, swivel seats. Well, I wasn't going to talk about them either, but I'm going to go back even further. But before we go back there, as an example, I have 3.5 pages right here in my hand. You're only looking at page one of 1969 Ford Mustang options, okay?
Oh, wow.
Okay. And I say that because Don has a 1969 Ford Mustang, okay?
He does. It's lovely.
Yes. But these options are everything, you know, engines, interiors, and everything. And when Mustang first appeared a few years earlier, they were known as the car that you could basically tailor to your own wants and needs and all that. So, where'd he come from? Anyway, so that's an example of how they were. This is in the 60s. They had all sorts of options. But we're going back, way back here, and you could show the first item of this. And this is an add-on for your car, or the first picture there. And this is a Kellogg engine-driven air pump. It's from 1915. Everlasting construction there, cost $15, price complete with gauge, 15 feet rubber tubing and all attachments, carefully machined to fit cars easily. Fills tires in 2 minutes or less. Filling tires, okay? So you had a lot of flats back in 1915, and so having a hand pump, and if you go into old auto catalogs and such from back there, you always see all these hand pumps. Well, here's something. You can hook this up to the engine of your car, actually ran off the transmission.
Does all the work for you.
And do that. And I've talked about that. I think I've talked about it on this show. And we have some cars in our museum that have the air pumps on it. Now, to really see, you have to crawl under the car to see it. Okay, which, I don't know, we don't want to really treat our guests like that. But one of our Daniels cars has the engine separate from the car. And if you go over there on the back end of that engine off the transmission, you see this little housing there, and that's an air pump. And you can see the little air fitting there. That's kind of the clue there. Oh. You didn't know that?
No. I recall the Packard.
Packard has
one. Packard has that little access door, like.
Correct. Yeah.
At the running board.
That's right, and has an access door, the hose we used to have with it, and gauge and everything, but you can see
Daniels
the pump.
It
says, yeah, I think all three of our Daniels
Ooh,
have them
wow.
actually.
All right.
But the one's easy to see because it's right there.
Yeah.
So anyway, that's the Kellogg air pump. And I saw another ad for that, and it says, don't ask a car owner to pump up his tires by hand when there is a 20 to 90 horsepower motor by his side. Hand pumping belongs to the dark ages, like hand cranking. Okay? So you know, it mentions hand cranking also, is you could also get a Kellogg compressed air starter for engines along with this. And basically you would have a storage tank somewhere located on your car, have 150 pounds of pressure in a storage tank. So you press a button and there's a distributor, so it distributes this compressed air to each cylinder to get it running or to get it started in there. So you know, that there's another thing. So we're talking about air pumps and for your tires and air starter for the engines of your car. Okay, you go to the next one. It's the Rohrbacher Auto Power Tire Pump. And it's called the Little Windjammer, which I think is a cool little name. And the reason I really got this, I like the pictures.
Look at those guys.
Yeah, the guy on the left there is, you know, hand pump, and look at the way he is. He's all angry and sweaty, and his eyes are
very upset.
Whereas the guy on the right with his Rohrbacher Auto Power Tire Pump, he's all comfortable and smiley and stuff. No more backbreaking, pleasure-destroying hand pumping. So, and I came across, I've come across a bunch of these, all kinds of brands out there. There's another one there, and it said tire pumping is not tired pumping. Get it? Clever? But the advertisement was kind of boring, so I figured, we're not going to bore.
No, I like these guys.
Yeah. These guys are great, yeah.
Yeah, these guys are good.
So, that's that. So, that's air pumps, which would be an accoutrement for your car back in 1915. The Rohrbacher is actually from 1910, so we're talking that whole era there where you couldn't just go to the local convenience store and if it's a Wawa for the free air, some of the other places you have to pay. And they allow you to do it with a credit card, which, anyway, I won't get into that. Okay. How about horns? Okay, cars didn't have horns back then. I'm going to use a Model T Ford as an example. In 1909, when they first started, they had types. They had two types of horns you could get with them, but then a lot of cars didn't have them at all. But also in 1909, there was something called Le Testaphone. Okay, you could show the next picture there. There, that's one. That's a drawing of one, and we have one of them on one of our vehicles in the museum, and that's a Le Testaphone.
Is that two words?
Le. Okay. Testaphone. Yeah, and most places you just see it says Testaphone, and it's made in France, and other than that, I cannot find any information. I looked all over, high and low. This, I even was looking. You better sit down for this.
Okay, hold on. Yes.
Online in French newspapers for something about it. Yeah.
That's dedication.
That is dedication. But they didn't have anything. Okay. But I did come across something. So it's called The Novelty of the Season, a musical horn. It does not give an unearthly yell or a hollow groan.
Well, thank goodness.
Yes, yes.
I've been worried
about
that.
Distributed in the U.S. by a company in New York City. Unlike most of the recent products in this line, its sound is really pleasing and does not cause shivers to run up the spine of the inoffensive pedestrian. Isn't that great? Great stuff, huh?
I wonder how the horses felt.
I don't know. Probably left out. They wanted one. Okay. Let's see. They say it made more friends in the short time it's been on the market than any other device.
It's made friends?
Yes,
oh,
it
wow.
has made more friends. And the friends are not numbered among the automobilists alone. So there's the horses I guess.
There you
go. Guess. I don't know.
The horses are
okay.
happy.
This horn gives a bugle call without requiring any skill on part of the operator. Okay, speaking of bugle calls, I'm going to read some things here. This is out. You better sit for this, too.
Oh.
This is out of the Daily Times newspaper back in 1911 out of Davenport, Iowa.
Okay.
It says, no more nerve-wracking honks, no more shrieking sirens, no more clanging gongs. Instead, a musical bugle call or the tune of a popular song will warn Davenport pedestrians that a motor car is approaching if Le Testaphone becomes popular among the local automobilists. Okay?
Wow.
Further, W.R. Weir, the insurance man, has become interested in the horn through a friend, C.T. Darling, in Florida. In writing to Mr. Weir, Mr. Darling says, "This is the greatest novelty I have ever seen in the auto horn. It is a perfect bugle call. There is one on our machine here and attracts more attention than a circus. As an advertisement as well as a pastime, it is well worth having."
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. You could show the next picture and there's going to be a real live horn.
There it is.
That's ours. That's on our 1907 Dorier buggy yacht, made in Reading, by the way. And so that's it. And you can show the next picture also, and that's it closer. And I'm going to try to describe what's going on. This is out of another magazine here. But it says, it resembles an ordinary bulb horn in its operation, but has four reeds, okay? So you can see at the top, there is the horn you would squeeze like a regular bulb horn, each with a separate trumpet. Each reed has a separate trumpet. Each time the bulb is pressed, the piston arrangement actuates a ratchet wheel at the base of the horn. Okay, so in that horizontal cylinder is a little ratchet wheel, revolving a valve which directs the air to various tubes in turn. The effect of pressing the bulb lightly a number of times in rapid succession is to give a fanfare closely resembling a bugle call, as the different notes of the group are sounded in sequence and sometimes in combination. The combinations can be controlled and varied at will by adjusting the valve. So there it is. If you could go back to the previous picture so you can see the whole thing. So you see the bulb at the top, and you squeeze it, and the mechanism there, and the four different notes can come out. And that horizontal cylinder is a little ratchet. And if you're familiar with like the way a trumpet plays, you know, you can push one of the keys down, and it's going to redirect air from one place to another, so it'll give it a different sound. So that's kind of what's going on with that.
Has anyone ever tried to play that?
No, and I don't think the stuff actually, I think it's kind of stuck together.
Yeah.
I would love to play it as an example to show visitors.
Oh, yeah.
But if you show visitors how to squeeze a bulb horn, now you're in the danger because we got several cars with
them. I remember years ago, we're talking like 13 years ago maybe.
Mm-hmm.
I remember we bought bulb, the rubber bulb replacements, because a couple of ours were cracked.
Yeah, I think that was one of them.
And I think this was one of them, and I don't know if it ever.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to do
I'm dying of curiosity.
We'll have to go over there sometime.
Yeah,
when
what are you
no
doing after the show, Dan?
No
well, you're going to try to play
we've got
Le
a meeting tomorrow at the museum,
there you
so
go.
There. Yeah.
We'll try to play Le Testaphone.
Yeah, okay. Oh, it gets better, though, okay? So it was made in brass only. It cost you $22 with detachable bracket, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I have to read another thing. This is out of the Hancock Democrat of Greenfield, Indiana, from July of 1911.
Wow. Okay.
I saw this very same article in other paper cells, so I guess it's a press release thing.
Yeah,
Motors with Music in London. Popular tunes on motor car horns produced by means of brass cylindrical records such as are used for gramophones are the latest sounds heard in London streets. For some time, it has been possible to get a testaphone which will play four notes, but the new motor car horn will play a whole series of tunes. One was heard a few days ago playing that charming tune, Let's All Go Down the Strand. Are you familiar with that song?
No.
Okay. Well, funny you asked.
Well,
you didn't ask.
Okay.
Well, I'm going to tell
what
you anyway.
Is that song?
Okay. Let's All Go Down the Strand. It was a popular song written in 1909 by C.W. Murphy and Harry Castling. All right. The Strand is a street in London which had a popular music hall, had a reputation for being a place for a lively night out. The song, since then, has been part of London culture.
Oh.
Okay. So, last night, I had to listen to it. And
I wrote it down.
There is a, there, you go there, And there's like a little website, and it has several versions of this. And so I go to the one from, I'm thinking it was 1909, could be 1910. Mm-hmm. And the guy's there, a little video, and he has an old-time record player.
Yeah.
And he puts his record on, and it's all scratchy and
oh,
stuff.
Great.
And you hear this guy sing, he's a British man.
Yeah.
And he said, the guy who made the video said it was Harry Castling was singing the song. And you go on another site, and there's all the words, and it just talks about, you know, going to this place to have fun. And it just, it's really neat. And so
cool.
I was telling you earlier that I was watching Willie Nelson with the with the what was her name again? The Muppets band?
Dr. Teeth and Electric
yeah.
Mayhem, I think.
Okay. So I don't know if you, the viewers out there, you know, you get on this and you want to see the next one, the next
yeah,
one, the next
yeah.
one, and you're seeing all this stuff. But anyway, this is what started with this song. And it's really neat because, you know, you're sitting there listening to it and thinking, that's how it sounded in 1909.
Yeah.
And you're looking,
wow.
you know, I'm looking at pictures on my computer of this testaphone, which is from there. And it just kind of, I think it's pretty neat how that does it.
Wow.
So. Okay, enough about testaphone. How about another accoutrement?
Okay.
How about windshields?
Oh,
okay, and you
yeah.
can show the next one there. That is just a really cool advertisement. So it's the Mezger, I'm hoping I say that right, Mezger automatic windshield.
I think Mezger sounds good.
Okay, up or down with one hand without stopping your car. It costs $25. Mm. Or $27.50, depending on the size. And, you know, it shows a lady there kind of angling the top part of the windshield because the bottom part is kind of, you know, fixed there. But the top part you could do. And it's, or you could, I don't know, I guess it's a really hot day and there's no
wow.
bugs. You put it all the way down to get the full breeze. So yeah,
wow.
that's another thing. You would get these windshields, and I told you a price for, which means you would have a car without a windshield, and you wanted
uh-huh.
a windshield.
Uh-huh.
So you talk about an accoutrement. We're so used to windshields today, you don't think twice about it.
Yeah.
I'm sure cars have to have it now by the regulations
yeah.
and such. So that was thing. And going back to 1909, the Ford Model T, it was optional to have a windshield, and you had three different types, and this Mezger was one of them, okay? So I don't know what kind of car is depicted in that picture. Didn't really look at it. Okay, we're gonna go on to the next.
I feel like we have cars that have a windshield.
Yeah.
Very similar
yeah,
to this.
Yeah, and you figure, okay, this is the Mezger automatic one, but again, Ford had Rands and Troy mm-hmm. windshields also.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe they all work the same way, but maybe not as well as Mezger because it was the automatic.
I'm really curious how it's automatic because it still looks like she's reaching up there to fold it.
I think it's probably like a tight fit.
Uh-huh.
So kind of like the screen of your laptop right there. You can angle it and it's going to stay there.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
That's how I was thinking about it. All right.
Cool. All right.
So the next thing here is the Rio four-door. And you notice it's not F-O-U-R, but it's F-O-R-E. So it's four as in the front. And if you look at the picture of the car in the middle, it does not have doors. So in their advertising, this is a two-page advertisement. You're just looking at the first page because the second one's almost all text. And it says, you can have the Rio any way you want it. Number one, with the fixed four-door. Two, with the put-on and take-off door, which is the picture at the top. Three, with an open front, which is the middle there. And then the bottom, you can buy just the door by itself and put it on whenever you want it.
Wow.
So you could put your door on, and, you know, again, I can't pick, but you know, I see these like Jeep type things and you can get, and I know Ford Broncos had them way back
mm-hmm.
and you could do that, but it's just interesting. And you look at cars from back then and I'm thinking for the windshield, I don't think they had doors in the front. So so a lot of cars didn't have it. They just had them in the back.
Yeah.
And it also mentions here in this advertisement, some people want the four-door all the time. Some don't want it at all. Some would like it one day and not another. Depends upon weather and time of the year, for there is some heat in the forward compartment.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't even have a mm-hmm. heater. That's another accoutrement we're not even going to
get
into.
Oh, yeah, that's a whole other topic.
So that door, if you wanted to buy it, which is shown in the lower left-hand corner, would cost you $25. So
I love it.
Yeah.
The door.
The door.
$25.
Yeah, okay, both sides.
Or I think, is it our SUV, the red one? I think it has doors in the front, but they don't open. Like they're...
Maybe. If they open, they're only...
They're
low.
Like fake doors.
Yeah.
But you couldn't really open it. You can see there the handbrake, you know, is in your way. You can't mm-hmm. swing it open. Mm-hmm. So it's like a fake door.
Yeah.
But
it'll keep the heat in.
But it will keep the heat in.
But I'm thinking also, you want to be have the latest gadget, you're going to have a door in the front of your car.
Well, that's true too.
Yeah.
Maybe it looks like you're fancier.
So we're going to have to do a walkthrough tour tomorrow at the museum.
Yes. Looking look for these random things.
Accoutrements, yes. Okay.
Mesger windshield.
Okay. So last picture here. And again, yep. There's the windshield. And, you know, just because it's a neat advertisement, I wanted to end with it. And I'm looking, and there's no four door on there. So.
Did you see in the Rio, though?
Mm-hmm.
Look, it looks like they have the windshield folded down there in the
yes.
front.
Yes. Oh, I didn't say. Yeah, it had the open front, okay, the middle picture to the left of it. It says open front, $1,250, top and Mesger automatic windshield extra.
It does say that. Look at that.
I forgot about that. Thank you for bringing it up. And that also had a top extra, another
extra,
accoutrement.
Yep, yep.
So anyway, that's
so
it. So just thanks to Don and Sue. And I talked to Don last night and told him he has to watch it tonight. So
I talked to Don last week.
Really?
Yeah. I ran into Don.
Yes, that's
picked
right.
Picked up our Vim.
Yeah.
So hi, Don. Again.
You know which Don I'm talking
yeah.
about.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. Yeah. He mentioned seeing you. So, all right.
Cool.
That's it.
All right.
So, try to top that little misaccoutrement.
Oh, I don't know if I can. I got into this problem that I seem to have a lot, which is I think I have this really easy thing to find, and it's never mm-hmm. easy. So I stumbled upon this car a long time ago, and I don't even remember why anymore, but I was fascinated by it. So I had to dig further, and I put it on my list of things to talk about someday. So I went in there for this month's show, and I was like, all right, I'll do that. But it took me back to an earlier car, and that's what I'm going to start with. So scroll through my events here, okay. This is a patent drawing from Paul M. Lewis for an automobile, and the date on there, it's tiny, but the date on there is he filed it October 3rd of 1933. So Paul M. Lewis is an interesting fellow. He, in 1933, in Idaho Springs, Colorado, starts a company because he wants to build vertical takeoff and landing airplanes. So that means essentially a plane that doesn't need a runway.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just foot, foot down, just like that.
I was going to ask you to repeat that.
Now, for some reason, too, he also had this idea that he wanted to mass market a three-wheeled car. I should also say a three-wheeled aerodynamic car. He was really into aerodynamics. The whole aviation field was really influential for him, like Zeppelins. I think of a Zeppelin definitely when I look mm-hmm. at this drawing. There's a cross-section rendering of it. You can see from the side and then also from the front. what he's envisioning here. And he is going to call this the Aeromobile, A-I-R-O mobile. And when I started reading about this, I immediately thought of the Dymaxion.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Dymaxion. Also looks very blimp-like.
Yes.
Zeppelin-like. This is a little different. Now, the Dymaxion was a Buckminster Fuller brainchild, and Buckminster Fuller is himself an interesting person, and we could do a whole show about him. But he was really interested in like this utopian future that he envisioned, and he came up with this Dymaxion car that you see here, which was supposed to fly. His vision was that this thing would fly. There would be wings that you could attach to this. And when you're on the street driving around, you could take the wings off so you wouldn't knock out your people in the other lane.
The wings were an accoutrement.
The wings were an accoutrement. And he really built this Dymaxion airplane car because before this, he came up with a Dymaxion house. Now that's at the Henry Ford. You can go see this at the Henry Ford in Dearborn, Michigan. And I've talked to someone who visited and was able to walk inside of this thing. And I'm really jealous because I love this. I want to go see this in person. Now, Buckminster Fuller, he was okay with cities. It's not like he thought they were bad, but he wanted a lot of people to not live in the city. You should be able to live in nature, kind of like the city was for work and business mm-hmm. type things. When you're downtime, you should be in nature and the quiet and reconnecting with the earth. That was his idea. And he didn't want nature to be kind of scarred with infrastructure. So he needs a flying car so you can get to your house, which you should not need to have a road get to your house. And then you can fly your car into the city, take the wings off and drive around and do what you need to do. So I'm not the only one that made the connection between the Aeromobile and the Dymaxion. I read that a couple times, but it was definitely in my mind. We actually did a Facebook Live show about the Dymaxion car and Buckminster Fuller and everything. So maybe I'll link that. When we share this link on our Facebook page, maybe I'll also link that show so you can check him out. But back to the Aeromobile. Besides the fact that the Aeromobile was not intended to fly, that's one big difference between this and the Dymaxion. The other one is that, unlike the Dymaxion, the Aeromobile drove and steered through the front wheels. So it's got the two front wheels and a single back wheel. And the rear wheel did not even have a brake. I read in the one article that it was really just along for the ride, which I thought was a great way of putting it.
Okay.
The engine was designed by Franklin Motors.
Okay.
So Franklin, we're going to get into this a little bit in a moment, but Franklin at this point was no longer building cars, but they were for about 30 years producing
air-cooled
cars. Pretty prolific. So this is an air-cooled engine in here. And he started working, Paul Lewis started working with engineers Carl Doman and Edward Marks, who were with Franklin, to develop this air-cooled, opposed for 129 cubic inch air-cooled engine. It was rated at 60 horsepower, and it could travel up to 80 miles per hour. And again, the engine drove the front wheels through a Spicer constant velocity joints. So Spicer is they didn't start locally, but they had a local plant, right?
They did. I think
there
they were.
A Spicer plant in Pottstown.
Yeah.
But I don't know if that was necessarily their headquarters.
No, right.
Yeah.
It's complicated.
So who knows? This could have had a Pottstown piece on it. Not sure.
Mm-hmm.
And supposedly also, some of these rear, front components were cobbled together from Citroen parts too. And I'm not sure if one of these guys is Paul Lewis. I'm assuming they are. One of them is, but I don't know that for sure. So this is 1937 now. It took him a few years because he started this company in 33. But in 37, he comes out with this aeromobile, builds this, and he brags about the 80 miles per hour, that it has a 43.6 mile per gallon gas mileage. And, you know, look how frugal this car is. It has a 2,200-pound chassis, and he really attributes its good performance to the aerodynamics and the streamlining of it. And the look of it, now I'm just talking about the looks, he enlisted Jean Tiarda. I'm probably saying that wrong.
I think you're saying it right.
Am I? Great. Dutch automotive stylist and engineer. Mm-hmm. Now, he worked on the Chrysler Airflow, which you see up there at the top, and the Lincoln Zephyr at the bottom. And I really see a lot of Lincoln Zephyr in that car, personally, when I look at it. And Tiarda himself, he was really influenced by Paul Jaret, who was another automotive designer who and aviation designer. He worked on Zeppelins, but he also worked for Audi and Benz as well later. And he was also into the streamlining and the aerodynamics, and their stuff's really interesting. And I could probably also do a show just on these two gentlemen easily, because they have a really interesting career. So in 1937, Lewis takes the aeromobile prototype on a year-long tour, 45,000 miles, in hopes of finding backers, you know, who'll support this and help him mass market this car. He wants to sell it for like a couple hundred bucks. He really wants this to be pretty cheap, $550, I read somewhere.
Okay.
And for whatever reason, because he seemed to have some interest here at first, he goes back and redesigns the front end for 1938, and that's what you're looking at right here. Back in 37, you can see especially the headlights are kind of mounted up there on the fenders. In 38, he comes back, and they're now incorporated into the fenders, into that curve. Well, when he got back to all this in 1938, the interest was gone, pretty much, and he didn't have any backers. And his company goes bankrupt in 1939, and he only builds this aeromobile prototype, essentially. Real quick, there he is again. Franklin, real quick, before we go on to the car that started this all, well, my interest in this, the Franklin automobile, we talked about that briefly. They were around for about 30 years, I guess, building air-cooled cars out of Syracuse, New York. So the cars, they stopped building those in 34, and a couple of ex-employees bought the company and renamed it Air-Cooled Motors. Air-cooled, one word, air-cooled.
Mm-hmm.
Two of those former employees were this Carl Doman and Ed Marks, who worked on the engine for the aeromobile. But air-cooled motors really got into aviation stuff. And that engine that they developed for the aeromobile, they then sort of became this Franklin 4AC 150 engine, which you see at the bottom. And it was used in several small aircraft in the 40s. Like the Piper J3 Cub that's up there in the corner. Piper, of course, is a Pennsylvania company out of Lock Haven, Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. So that's a neat little Pennsylvania connection. But in 1947, air-cooled, and I should also note, air-cooled still use the Franklin name a lot. That's their factory in 1947. You can see Franklin is... it's hard to see, but that oval logo under air-cooled motors is Franklin. I don't think they were allowed to do business as Franklin. They had to change the name, you know, legally, but they still use that Franklin name.
I have seen bunches of the engines, like from the 40s, late 40s even, and they had the Franklin, and even the way the word Franklin was cast in the engine was the same.
That same script.
Same style
that they did. Yeah, they kept that name. I guess it had good, even though they went out of business, I mean, it still had a good reputation, so they kept it. Well, in 1947, air-cooled was purchased by the Tucker Car Corporation to make an engine for the 1948 Tucker sedan. And Tucker canceled all of air-cooled's aviation contracts because they wanted air-cooled to focus on their car engine. And that was about 65% of air-cooled's business. So that was pretty much going to be the end for them. Because we all know how Tucker turned out. But that's the factory back in 47. So that's the Airmobile. Plus a little more, I had to throw in the Franklin and Tucker stuff too. But Paul Lewis was not deterred from making a mass market three-wheeled aerodynamic car a reality. He comes back in the 1960s with a new design. And this is the car that originally caught my eye. He ends up calling this the Fascination. This is more Jetson-y looking now to me.
It's more what?
Jetson-y. Yeah. I can see George Jetson flying around in this thing. Again, it's not a flying car, although he really like wants it to look like one. Like he really goes for that airplane streamlined look still. This one has a big propeller on the back, as you might be able to see there in that drawing. You can see it a little better in this ad from the Greeley... Colorado newspaper. You can see that big propeller on the back there. So this comes out of, now we're in 1962 when he starts working on this project again. He starts a new company called the Highway Aircraft Corporation in Lakewood, Colorado. And this is the first car that he builds with the propeller on the back. It's in an accident, so he abandons this propeller idea. Now there he is, Paul Lewis, next to another one that he built, not a propeller one. So he gets rid of the propeller and he uses instead a Volkswagen air-cooled Type 3 engine that he puts in the tail end. And he takes this on another tour, although it's not a driving tour so much. It's more of like a display tour, like that ad said about on display in the community building. That's the kind of stuff he does. He takes it to the Stapleton Airport in Denver to display it. And then for whatever reason, he moves the company out of Colorado and he goes to Sydney, Nebraska to a former U.S. Army depot. And he starts building the Fascination there. And that's one of the ones that the other four, he built five total. That first one with the propeller is not around anymore, but then he built four others, and I think they're all still around. So this is one of those four. He also contracts the Egging Manufacturing Company of Gurley, Nebraska to build the steel body.
And what's the name of that company?
Egging. They are still around today. They do heavy steel fabrication. So that company's still around. And he wants this to be 130 mile per hour automobile, which I don't know where you're going to drive 130 miles per hour in 1960 whatever safely. And he wants it to have 180 degree turning capability. There's the back of it. Pretty wild looking.
Very Jetson-y.
Yes.
Yes.
Very George Jetson. He also had this idea that he was going to use a Nobel gas plasma engine for the Fascination. There's an ad where he talks about it a little bit. It's it It's a new type of thermonuclear energy operating the Nobel plasma engine that has no air intake, emitting no exhaust at all, using a hermetic gas chamber, and it goes on, and essentially, the fuel is self-contained and hermetically sealed in the cylinders, which are initially charged at the time of manufacturing, carrying their own power supply that will last approximately 60 to 75,000 miles with no fail of efficiency. Cylinders can be recharged quickly and simply for about $250 to $300 per cylinder. He doesn't get there. They all have these Volkswagen or like a Renault. I think some of them had a Renault engine in them. But yeah, he built five of these total. And he had all the EMA fuelless motor. He's advertising that again. And you can, that's from the Sydney, Nebraska years. But he does not ever utilize that engine. It stays Volkswagen or Renault. The four latter ones are all still in existence. One is at the National Automobile Museum out in Nevada, which I think is the Harrah's collection, essentially. That's the name of the Harrah collection. Mm-hmm. The others are privately owned. I saw one popped up at Amelia a few years ago.
Okay.
So that is the Fascination. And I saw a photo of this, and I was interested, and then I found all that other stuff that he tried about 25 years before with the Aeromobile, which had an interesting history. So we are actually out of time. So I thank you all for joining us here in June. I hope that we see you at the museum this summer for our Back to the Future exhibit. If you can't make one of those special events surrounding it, the display will be up in the lobby all summer. So we hope to see you there. Hopefully you can join us for Cars and Cones or Duryea Day. Maybe bring your really cool car, truck, or motorcycle. We'd love that. And in the meantime, we will see everyone in July. Thanks for joining me, Dan.
You're
welcome. Always.
It's been a blast.
It has. Blast off. Mm-hmm. We will see you all in July. Thanks, everybody.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.